High Bridge Audio presents Pictures of You by Caroline Leavitt. Read for you by Robin Miles. Chapter 1. There's a hornet in the car. Isabelle hears a buzz and then feels a brush of wing against her cheek. A grape-sized electric motor sings past her right ear. What's it doing out in this weather? She wonders. It rumbles past her again, and she practically jumps. She tries to wave it outside, but instead it kamikazes to the back of the car, navigating among her cameras. Which is worse, she thinks, waiting for the sting, or the sting itself. She opens all the windows wider. September fog is rolling across the highway, westbound US 6. Isabelle's windshield clouds. At first, she doesn't panic. She's been driving for 20 years already. She's a good, careful driver. And right now, all this cloudiness is just an unwanted surprise, a trick of weather. She switches on the headlights before she sees how much worse the lights make everything, how they reflect the fog. She tries the parking lights instead, which are a little better. They cut a small visual path on the road for her. Already she feels a headache the size of a hard, shiny dime forming behind her eyes. Isabelle strains to see the road, checks her gas gauge, which shows half empty. She slows down. She wants to keep driving, but might have to get off at an exit in Connecticut to fill up her tank. Isabelle rubs at the window. She can still see. In the back seat, she's got money she took from the bank to help get her resettled until she can find work. All her cameras are here, and one small suitcase stuffed with clothes. Let Luke toss the rest. Let him give them to Goodwill, or his new girlfriend, or his new baby. She knows this is crazy, but right now she's capable of anything. She could reinvent herself. She could blot out her past. A green sign, leaving Cape Cod, flashes by, and she starts to breathe. People sit in traffic for hours just to get here. They come from Boston and New York to spend 2 weeks in a tiny cottage and bread their bodies with beach sand and tanning lotion and absorb more sun than is healthy. Tourists collect the beach glass like it was diamonds instead of chipped pieces of soft drink bottles. And though everyone always tells her how lucky she is to live here, she's never wanted anything more than to leave. Every time a visiting friend gets ready to leave, she's had to stop herself from begging them to take her with them. This isn't the first time she's run away, but the first time was a lifetime ago, back when she was 16, and God knows that doesn't count. Now she has a little money, a profession, and a dirt-cheap illegal sublet in New York City that's available for as long as she wants it, courtesy of her friend Michelle. She yearns for cities where people don't make you feel there is something wrong with you because you live there year-round. She tugs at her thin necklace, lapis on a gold chain that was a gift from Luke for her last birthday. And in a flare of despair, she yanks it off in one brief rip. She throws it out the window and lets the fog swallow it up. She tugs off the wedding ring he gave her, too, a broad gold band, wide enough to have her name scratched on the inside, and bounces it onto the highway. She checks her rearview mirror, wondering if Luke will come after her. She squints at the sky. Maybe the fog will lift. There's still rays of sun out there, shooting through breaks in the clouds. God, startling people into paying him some attention. That's what her mother used to say. A sign. Isabelle glances up at the sky again. If you want to talk about signs, talk about how the sky had looked just this way, the first time Isabelle had brought Luke home. She was just 15, and he was 25, and working at the local gas station, a job that didn't exactly go over big with her mother. Of course, Luke's age made it even worse. She was so in love. It was like being insane. She couldn't breathe when she was near him, couldn't eat or sleep, and her brain felt rewired. Luke was the one who cleaned her mother's windshield without leaving a single smear, who put gas in the car and checked the tires and the shocks. She knew his name because it was embroidered in red on his pocket. He had a green bandana that he wore like a headband in his long, glossy hair, and he always rolled up his sleeves so Isabelle could see his muscles. When he smiled at Isabelle, his eyes were full of light. He looked at her like she was the most interesting thing he had ever seen. When her mother was paying inside, he told Isabelle that he wanted to go live on the Cape, right by the ocean, and he almost had enough money to do it. He had asked Isabelle for her phone number and suggested they go to a movie.
"Not on your life,"
her mother said, coming up behind him.
"She's way too young for you and way too smart, and she's going to college to be somebody."
Keeping her eyes fixed on the road, Isabelle opens the glove compartment and takes out the St. Christopher medal her mother gave her, needing its reassurance. Impulsively, she loops it around her neck. Nora, her mother, would be stunned to know that Isabelle had kept it, that in fact, this necklace is something she truly treasures. Everything had seemed like a wide-open road back then. And of course, that was before she knew that everything she had ever hoped for was impossible.
"Safe travels,"
her mother had told her, fastening the chain about Isabelle's neck. Even though Christopher's sainthood was stripped a long time ago, even though Isabelle no longer believes in saints. Isabelle and Luke came home one evening when Nora was supposed to be at work at the library. They'd been seeing each other a year then. It was a summer evening, and Isabelle wanted to pick up money so they could go to dinner. But as they pulled up, her heart sank, because there was Nora's little red sedan in the driveway.
"Cheese it, the cops,"
she said, trying to stay light. And then as they got closer, she saw all these bright bolts of color scattered across the front lawn.
"What the fuck?"
Luke said. He started to laugh.
"Is this her way of spring cleaning?"
he said. But Isabelle gripped his arm.
"They're my clothes."
Her voice was a rasp. There was her favorite blue dress, her winter coat, and all her junk jewelry sparkling among the dandelions. Her shoes were thrown on the bushes, her straw hat on the walk, her St. Christopher medal gleaming on the lip of the lawn. The yard was a Jackson Pollock of clothes. Then the door banged open, and there was Nora, tall and beautiful back then, in the sleek green suit she had worn to work at her job in the library, her hair caught in a pin. Her arms were full of clothes, and she stared hard at Isabelle and Luke, then opened her arms so the clothes tumbled out onto the front steps. Isabelle leaped from the car.
"Mom,"
she cried.
"You don't follow my rules, you don't live under my roof,"
Nora shouted, slamming the door shut so fiercely that Isabelle began to cry.
"Mom,"
she wailed. She made her way to the front door, grabbing up the St. Christopher medal, picking up her sweaters, her skirts, bunching them in her arms. Her heart was racing so fast she was dizzy. She banged on the front door, rang the bell, but there was no response. She dug out her key, and then she saw the new shiny lock.
"Mom,"
she cried, slamming her hands against the door.
"Mom!"
She was banging on the door when she felt Luke touching her.
"Shh,"
he said. He led her away, and when she bent down to get her clothes, he said, roughly,
"Leave them. We'll get you new ones, better ones."
He guided her back to the car,
And then there was nowhere else for Isabelle to go, even if she had wanted to. Except with Luke. All she had with her were her cameras. Drive slow, she told him. She said it was because the cops around here were such hard asses, but it was really because she wanted to give Nora a chance. She kept expecting her to run from the house, to call Isabelle, Isabelle, to stop Isabelle before she did something that couldn't be undone. Isabelle and Luke drove to the Cape, landing in a tiny town named Oak Rose, a place right outside Yarmouth that all the signs said was famous for its sunny beaches and fried oysters. The beaches, though, were small and crowded, and Isabelle didn't like oysters. Almost immediately, Luke got a job at a local bar cafe called Josie's. Isabelle got a job taking pictures at You Must Have Been a Beautiful Baby, a cut-rate child photography place where no one cared if the shots were artistic or you had a degree, as long as you were fast and could focus a camera. No one had come looking for Isabelle. Her mother had never called. Then the owner of Josie's died, and Luke took all the money he had saved and got a loan to buy it, renaming it Luke's. In that moment, Isabelle somehow knew her mother would never come for her, and Luke would never leave. She wore the St. Christopher medal all through her new high school, forging her mother's name on the paperwork, getting her records transferred, not really making friends because who else at 16 lived with their boyfriend and not their parents? Who else worked every shift she could at the Leaning Tower of Pizza in order to save some money for film instead of going out and having fun? She wore it through the times she'd called home and gotten no answer, gripping it for comfort and hope. She'd worn it while she worked at the photo studio, loving the feel of it against her skin. The slide and flash as she adjusted a child's hair or repositioned her light meter. She swore the medal made her customers behave better because they thought she was a believer, when really, she had no idea what she believed in. And now here she is, 36 and married and no longer a child, with no child of her own. There was never enough money for her to get the college degree she thought she'd have. Though she works at her photography, she's never sold a photo or had a show. The necklace brings her bright, glimmery hope. And ridiculous as it is, it comforts her to feel it around her neck. It still makes her feel that things can change. She rolls up the windows and turns on the air conditioner. The car clicks and knocks. Luke had spent the last few years trying to get her to buy a better car, a little compact in a bright color, instead of this black box that was always breaking down. How can you love something that never runs right? Luke always said. And her joke response was always, well, I love you, don't I? 3 hours later and she's still driving. She knows she has to stop for gas, so she gets off I-95 South and heads deeper into Connecticut. The weather is muggy and strange, as if it doesn't know what it wants, can't decide if it's going to rain or turn sunny. She's in a white, summery dress, but still, sweat beads on her back. With one hand, she tries to gather up her hair, so long she's practically sitting on it. Sometimes at the photo studio, the kids stare at her and ask her if she's a witch with all that black hair, if she can do magic. A good witch, she says, smiling. But today, she's not so sure. The wire-rimmed glasses she needs to drive slide heavily on her nose. When she takes them off, there's a red mark on the bridge, like someone's underlined her for emphasis. You're too sensitive for your own good, Luke had always told her. And well, she is, isn't she? She feels the cold more than Luke does, bundling in sweaters as soon as the fall chill hits. The heat makes her wilt. She feels hurts more, too. the way, even after all this time, the cards she sends her mother always come back in the mail, scribbled across them in her mother's hand, addressee unknown. The way Luke sometimes looks at her when she surprises him at his bar. Though he says he's happy to see her, his blue eyes go cloudy, like an approaching storm. People comment on her sensitivity at work, too. Sometimes people say that she actually sees things that aren't quite there yet. She'll capture a serious, thoughtful look in a usually sunny child, or make a delicate little girl look steely. Some people say that Isabelle captures the very spirit of a child, that it's downright unearthly how you could look at one of Isabelle's images and somehow see a child's future. Years later, parents come back to the studio just to tell Isabelle how the serious and lawyerly-looking baby she had photographed now wanted to be an actuary, how the delicately posed baby had signed with the Joffrey Ballet. "How did you know?" parents would ask. "How could you know?" "I don't know," Isabelle would reply. Or sometimes, because it would make the customers happier, she'd lie and say, I just know. But she didn't know. She didn't know anything. She didn't even know what was happening in her own life. Within the past year, she had found a white, filmy scarf in the laundry basket, a silver bracelet in the kitchen, and once, a tampon in the waste basket when she wasn't having her period. All of them, Luke insisted, belonged to friends of his from the bar who dropped by. "Don't you think if I was hiding someone, I'd make sure to hide her things, too?" he asked. He acted like she was nuts. She came to his bar some nights and saw him, surrounded by beautiful women, laughing, letting their arms drape about his shoulder. But as soon as he saw Isabelle, he shook them off like raindrops and kissed her. But still, something felt off, like he wasn't really there with her. 3 nights ago, a call woke her from a deep sleep, and when she grabbed for the receiver, reaching across Luke, she swore she heard a woman quietly crying. "Hello?" she whispered, and the line went dead. And when she looked beside her, she saw, to her shock, that Luke's eyes were open and wet. "Baby, what is it?" she asked, alarmed. She pulled herself up, staring at him. "Just a dream," he said. "Go back to sleep." And he had rolled toward her, one arm on her hip, and in minutes he was asleep. But she lay awake, staring at the ceiling. Then this very morning, when Luke was at the bar, a woman called her, blurting her name. "Isabelle?" And then the woman told Isabelle she was Luke's girlfriend, how she had been his girlfriend for 5 years. "I know all about you, Isabelle," the woman on the phone said. "Don't you think it's time you knew about me?" Isabelle braced one hand along the kitchen counter. "I'm pregnant, and I thought you should know," the woman said. Isabelle's legs buckled. "Someone's at the door," she managed to whisper. And then she hung up the phone, ignoring it when it rang again. Pregnant. She and Luke had wanted kids desperately. She had tried to get pregnant for a decade before all the tests and herbs and treatments ground her down. Luke brushed away talk of adoption. "Is it the worst thing in the world if you and I don't have kids?" he said. Isabelle thought it was, but she didn't know what to do about it. She made Luke help her turn the spare room that was supposed to be a nursery into a dark room, and the only children who lived there were those whose faces she photographed. At first, when she found out about Luke's pregnant girlfriend, she thought it was the end of the world. And then she told herself it was only the end of one particular world. She surely deserved better than what she had. She would shed this life like a cocoon. Now her back aches, and she stretches against the seat. Last month, she had gone for a massage, and the masseuse, a young woman with a yellow ponytail, had tapped along her body. "You carry stress here," she said, thunking Isabelle's shoulder blades. "Here's anger," the sides of her hands wedged against Isabelle's neck. "Here's sorrow," she said, touching Isabelle's spine. And Isabelle gripped the edge of the massage table, wincing. "Here's sorrow."
"Smile, and you'll feel like smiling," her mother used to tell her. "God rewards happiness."
"That you must have been a beautiful baby. People always commented on her smile. Bright, glowing, drawing kids to her like iron to a magnet. But she can't smile now, no matter how hard she tries." Isabelle glances at her watch. It's mid-afternoon, and she's getting hungry. Her cell phone rings, but she doesn't pick it up, half afraid it's Luke's girlfriend again. "I don't even know her name," Isabelle thinks. By now, Luke is home and has found her letter. Maybe he's upset. Maybe he's grabbing his jacket and his keys, and he's gone off looking for her, desperate to find her. Maybe he's furious, smashing dishes on the kitchen floor, the way he did when she first told him she wasn't happy living there, that she felt the cape was suffocating her. In all the years they've been together, he's never hurt her, never raised a hand or even his voice. But he's smashed 5 sets of dishes, broken several glasses, and a figurine he had bought her as a joke, a Scottish terrier with a tiny gold chain. Maybe he isn't mad. Maybe he's just relieved. But really, who is she kidding? Of course he isn't home. Of course he hasn't read her pathetic letter. "Dear Luke, I want a divorce. Find a lawyer instead of me. Isabelle." Of course he's with this new woman. With this new baby. Angrily, she swipes at her eyes. She sees a baby, small and glossy as a pearl, with Luke's eyes and not hers. And then she shuts her eyes just for a second. And when she opens them, suddenly, she doesn't recognize where she is. The road is unfamiliar. Isabelle turns on the radio. Even though it's a rock station, Tammy Wynette wails out at her. Oh, good. A heart as battered as hers, and all she has to do is sing along as loud as she wants. If Tammy can survive, then so can she. She thinks of the money in her pocket, of her cameras settled in the back, maybe of her mother welcoming her back, the prodigal daughter.
"I never liked him,"
her mother will say about Luke, and Isabelle will hope to hear too,
"but I have always loved you."
Her mother has lived outside of Boston her whole life, endured her husband dying of a heart attack when he was only 30, coming out of a soupette carrying groceries, continued on through Isabelle running off with the man who fixed their car, a man she said she knew was trouble from day one. The fog is heavier now, the visibility terrible. Damn, she knows she's lost now. It was a mistake to take a side route, but she can always turn around and get back on the highway. Maybe she can stop at a diner, treat herself to a late breakfast, eat everything that's bad for her, everything she loves, eggs, bacon, sausage. The darkness gets to her. It doesn't feel natural at this time of the day, and even though she knows it's just fog, it feels spooky. Squinting, she tries to see more than a few feet ahead of her, but the fog's enveloping her, making her increasingly uneasy. She flicks the parking lights on and off to try to slice through the darkness, and then the fog moves again, and she sees, almost like pieces of a torn photo, patches of what's there,
Something red. A glint of chrome. A car stopped in the center of the road, turned the wrong way. Its lights completely dark. A fillip of red dress. She jolts. She knows the stopped car is not moving, but it still seems to be speeding up toward her anyway, growing larger and larger even as she tries to pull away from it. The road's too narrow, ringed with tall, thick trees. Her eyes dart on the road, but there's nowhere to go. There's no space to turn around, not enough length to stop in time, no matter how she's pumping her brakes. Oh, Jesus! Isabelle veers, trying not to hit the trees. The car slows, lurching her forward. Time turns elastic, stretching out, slowing. Then, shocked, she sees a woman with short, spiky blonde hair, a red dress frilling around her knees, coming into sharp focus, rising up like one of Isabelle's negatives in the milky developing fluid. And the woman is just standing there in front of her car, not moving, staring as if she knew this would happen and she was somehow waiting for it. And Isabelle swerves again, harder this time, the tires screeching, her heart clamped. "Get out of the road!" Isabelle screams. Frantic, she grips the wheel. "What are you doing?" she shrieks. But the woman seems pinned in place. In the distance, she can hear a voice, like a splash of pennies, and then she sees a child, a boy with dark flying hair, and when he sees her for a moment, he freezes too. His eyes lock onto hers, and for one terrifying moment, Isabelle feels hypnotized. For one second, Isabelle can't move either. And then she smashes on the horn, and he startles and bolts across the road, disappearing into the woods. And her car's going too fast, and she can't stop it. She can't control it. Her heart tumbles against her ribs. Her breath goes ragged. She's losing control, and despite herself, she's praying, "God, Jesus." Then she hears the hornet again, which flies past her out into the night, and then the woman finally moves, pressing herself back closer to the sedan, and it's too late. And the two cars slam together like a kiss. Chapter 2. Charlie Nash kneeled in his backyard, his hands covered with dirt, the fog all around him. His neck was filmed with sweat, and the air had a strange, clammy feel. But he wanted to get these plants, the bright, showy annuals, the dwarf pear trees with their roots diapered in purple burlap, in the earth, to surprise April and Sam when they came home. "Plants want to grow," he always told Sam. "All they need is just a little extra help sometimes." He crouched lower, touching the leaves of the strawberry plants. The soil should have been sandier for them, and there were some weeds poking up that he needed to tend to. But all in all, the strawberries would do fine. Well, he thought, plants do their best to stay alive wherever you put them. Just like people. He got up now and stretched, glancing at his watch again. Nearly 6. April would be done with her shift at the Blue Cupcake and just picking Sam up from after school. They'd be home soon. He felt a prickle of unease. He and April had had an argument that morning, and all day it had stayed with him, like a sour taste in his mouth. Right after breakfast, he had been rushing to get to a job, running late. April was following him from room to room so that he actually stumbled into her, knocking his funny bone against the door jamb. When he got to the bedroom and bent to grab his jeans, she snatched his arm, making him stop. Her breath came in little skips. "You fell asleep last night while I was talking to you," she said. He looked at her, bewildered. She was usually so understanding when work exhausted him. She'd turn down the bed and plump the pillows, and then kiss him sweetly goodnight. "You didn't hear what I said to you last night, did you?" He zipped the fly of his jeans and reached for a black t-shirt. She was pale and lovely in the light, but he had no time. "We'll make it up," he told her. "When?" She stepped back from him, her face closing like a door. "I try to talk and you don't listen." "Honey, it's just a busy time right now," What's with you today?
April shook her head. You have your own company. You could turn jobs away once in a while. You don't need to work that hard. You just want to. She tugged his arm. Sometimes I feel like I'm not even married anymore. His nerves were fraying, his stomach burned, and his elbow throbbed. He had 3 jobs that were late, and his clients were furious. He had to call several different suppliers because his usual brought him grade 2 wood, even though he had specified grade 1. Ed, his foreman, wanted to show him some problems with the central air that was being installed on yet another job. Charlie couldn't have this argument right now, and he certainly didn't want to have it in front of Sam. Charlie, I'm right here talking to you, April cried, her voice taking on an edge. Charlie went back into the kitchen, where Sam was staring down at his cereal.
Go get your school books, kiddo, he told Sam. You don't want to be late.
He ushered Sam out of the room, and as soon as Sam was gone, he turned back to April.
You know what? He said. I don't know what's with you today, but I can't deal with you like this.
She looked at him askance. Fine, then don't. Just go if you're going, just drive and don't come back. When she turned her back to him, he bumped his elbow again. He was so irritated that he couldn't help it. He snapped.
If it wasn't for Sam, maybe I would just keep driving, he said.
It didn't make him feel any better barking like that. But he couldn't shake his annoyance enough to apologize to make things right. He found and kissed Sam, and then stormed off to his car. Of course, he felt bad as soon as he got in the car. What did she think? That he liked being this tired? That he hadn't wanted to talk to her last night? To make love to her? He had wanted to. God, he had. Last night, he slid her nightgown from her beautiful shoulders, kissing her breasts, her stomach, the soft swell of her thighs. He fought his exhaustion. But then just as he was stroking her back, she said, Charlie, let's talk. And his desire switched off. He sat up, had done his best to listen, but Jesus, he was so tired. So tired. Why did they have to talk? Why couldn't they just feel? Her voice lulled him, the rhythm of it, and he fell asleep. He hadn't slept through the night, though. He stirred at 4 in the morning, and April wasn't in bed. He got up, looking for her, and when he walked past Sam's room, he saw the door was open and she was sleeping, pale and beautiful, nested in a chair that she had pulled close to Sam's bed. The two of them looked so peaceful and perfect that he hadn't wanted to wake her up. It was an argument, he told himself. It meant nothing. All married couples argued, didn't they? They fought and made up, and then they grew closer. What was love? What was it really? Sometimes he felt as if he didn't have a clue. He had fallen in love with April the second he had seen her, and they had married within months, the two of them, giddy with joy and surprise, hurtling toward their future. They had a child together and a whole life. And maybe it was stupid to question anything that good, because the truth was that he couldn't imagine his life without her. All day he had wanted to call her to apologize. He grabbed for the phone at 10, and then it rang. And it was the suppliers trying to argue with him about the grade of wood they'd given him. I see what I see, he told the supplier, and it isn't right. He was going to call April again at noon. But then he got a call from Ed, who told him that another job, a kitchen renovation that was supposed to have taken only 3 days, was running late. And Charlie had to go on site and take care of it. By the time things had calmed down, it was time for him to go home. Well, tonight he'd treat his family to someplace special for dinner. He'd woo April back, and things would be fine. Charlie studied the lawn. There by the fence, he'd put in a little goldfish pond for Sam. Maybe give Sam his own garden.
What do you want to grow? He had asked his son. Charlie had brought home books filled with pictures of plants, and for the past few evenings, all they'd been doing was looking at and exclaiming over the pictures. Judging from the one Sam had lingered over, Charlie was sure Sam was going to say roses or azaleas, but instead Sam wrinkled up his nose. A dog, he announced. Charlie's heart crumpled. April averted her eyes. He put one hand lightly on his son's silky hair. We'll see, he said quietly. It was a lie, and he and April both knew it. Though Sam, eyes gleaming, bounced about him like a ball. We'll see. We'll see what? It was the kind of thing his own father used to say when Charlie had begged for a dog himself. And Charlie had never gotten over thinking his father just might mean yes, even after time had gone on and on, and the dog he had yearned for had never materialized. But while Charlie could have cared for a dog, could have slept with a dog, cuddled it, and kissed his fur, Sam had asthma. Put him in a room where a dog had even strolled through, and Sam would have an attack. Feed him ice cream that was too cold, give him a day that was too muggy, something that made him laugh a little too hard or cry a little too deeply, and suddenly, terrifyingly, Sam's lungs clamped shut. There were too many days at the emergency room where Pete, Sam's pulmonologist, would look up and spot Sam and tease him. Hey, buddy. Hey, Sam. You missed me. You like us so much you came to visit again? You look too healthy to be here, sport. And the thing was, he did look healthy. He was a sturdy 9-year-old boy, with creamy skin and navy blue eyes and a sheath of thick chocolate hair. Looking at him, you wouldn't know anything was wrong. People died from asthma. Isn't that why he and April took Sam for checkups and monitored his breathing with the peak flow meter every morning? Charlie still marveled that here Sam was, alive in the world. Where in the world did I get such a wonderful boy like you? Charlie asked. Mars, Sam said. Jupiter. The planet Xyron. Some doctors said the salt air of the Cape was good for asthma. Another doctor told them to move to a drier climate. The doctors warned to keep Sam's visits to New York, where his grandparents lived, short, because of the pollution. The doorbell rang, loud and insistent. Even from back here, he could hear it. April had her key. He bet it was Jimmy, their paper boy, a kid who had a crush on April and blushed and dropped the change every time he saw her. The doorbell rang again, more insistently. Hold your horses, Charlie said, and headed for the door. He tripped on one of Sam's Legos and put it in his pocket and opened the door. Two cops were standing in front of him, glancing awkwardly at each other.
Charles Nash,
one asked, and Charlie nodded. A thought flew into his head. Maybe he was about to get sued. It had never happened before, but he knew it could. There was a client who tumbled into a pool he had built and made some threats. Once a man insisted that the grass Charlie had planted had attracted a gopher that bit his dog. But servers brought papers, not police. So why would they be here? There's been an accident. The youngest cop was talking. Charlie couldn't concentrate. He nodded, but he didn't know what he was nodding at. He stood out in the heat-soaked day, and the cop's words were an undertow, tugging him under.
That's what we think happened, the young cop said. The accident was in Hartford.
Hartford?
That's 3 hours away. Cops there have jurisdiction, but as a courtesy, they called here and we came to tell you.
Where were they? What are you talking about?
They can tell you more, but we know that the accident happened just off Interstate 84. It's the east side of Hartford. They're both at the hospital there.
They? Both of them? Charlie couldn't breathe.
No. My son's at after school. He stays there until 5 or 6, and then my wife picks him up from work.
The older cop stared at Charlie, narrowing his eyes as if he were trying to figure something out about him, something hidden or suspicious, almost as if Charlie were suspect.
The car's pretty totaled, the cop said. Anything in it burned.
What? Charlie looked at the cop, who was studying his shoes. The cops glanced at each other.
You know where they were headed?
One asked. Charlie felt a cold clutch about his ribs. They were headed home.
The cop shook his head. According to the Connecticut cops, it doesn't appear to have been the driver's fault, he said.
Charlie tried to stop whatever was banging against his skull.
Which driver? No alcohol, fog, but no speeding. Crystal clean record.
My wife's a great driver, he said. She's never had a traffic ticket. The cop leaned forward as if he were going to tell Charlie a secret.
Your wife's car was in the middle of the road with no lights, no flares or signals. It was facing the wrong way. Your wife was in the center of the road, and the boy ran into the woods. There was a 911 call, an asthma attack.
My son has asthma. Is he all right? What does my wife say happened?
The younger cop hesitated. We don't know, he said finally.
Charlie grabbed the handles of the railing.
You okay?
The cop said, leaning forward, and Charlie's air pipe squeezed shut even more. He thumped himself on the chest, and for a moment, he wondered if he were having one of Sam's asthma attacks.
Fine,
he said, and then he grabbed for his car keys, and one of the cops took his hand.
Can you have someone drive you? You don't look in any condition to drive 3 hours.
It's 3 hours, Charlie repeated. Just hearing the number hurt.
We have time, the cop said abruptly. We'll wait with you until you can get someone to drive you.
He called a few friends, but no one was home. Then he called his foreman, Ed, who came right over, got Charlie in the car, and then drove as fast as he could. Neither one of them spoke, and there was only the roar of the highway. The car didn't seem to be going fast enough for Charlie. The motor knocked, and he clamped his hands together, and then unclamped them. The streets were crowded with people, but they were all moving in slow motion. A woman stretched sluggishly up on tiptoes to reach for a magazine at a newsstand. An old man splashed a bottle of water onto the street, laughing, yah, yah, yah.
Everything's all right, Charlie told himself. People get things wrong all the time.
Ask 3 witnesses about a crime, and you'd get 3 different answers. Finally, they reached Hartford Hospital, solid and red brick. An ambulance whined past him, and Charlie felt suddenly nauseous. He dug his fingers into his palms, hunching over, sweating. It was a mistake. That was what it was, a mistake. He'd get to the hospital, see his wife and son. They would all go home. And this would all be an amazing story they'd laugh about later. The hospital was bright and noisy. Ed walked with him close by. In the elevator, the woman next to him clutched a bunch of oddly yellow daisies, sighed repeatedly, then backed away from Charlie, as close to the wall of the elevator as she could get. Charlie looked closer at the flowers.
Died, he thought in wonder.
The flowers were dyed. He leaned across the woman and punched the floor button, and she sighed again. The dyed petals fluttered with her breath. When the doors opened, he nearly stumbled.
I'll wait for you here,
Ed said, nodding toward a waiting room. He sat in one of the orange chairs and put his head in his hands. Charlie tried to snag a nurse, a doctor, to ask, where are they? Where are they? But every time he approached a nurse, she glided past him like quicksilver, shoes as whispery as cat paws. Every time he cried, doctor, the doctor glanced at him and then was pulled away.
Charlie headed for the main desk. A flurry of people were around it. A nurse looked up at him.
April Nash. Sam Nash, he said breathlessly.
The nurse blinked at him.
Oh, Mr. Nash.
Where can I find my son? Where's my wife? She touched his arm, making his heart skitter. It was never a good sign when they touched you. He had seen far too many television hospital dramas to imagine what was going to come next. The lowered voice, the steady gaze, the bad news. He jerked his arm away.
Let me get the doctor for you, she said.
No, no, you tell me, he said. But she started walking, and he followed her. And then there, at the end of the corridor, sitting up on a gurney, swimming in an oversized blue hospital gown, was a boy. Charlie strained his eyes, trying to make out a face, but he was too far away to tell who it was. There was a nurse beside the boy, banding a cuff about his arm. The floor was black, with blue and green and red lines to follow to different departments, and Charlie's shoes skidded on it, but he still ran as fast as he could. The boy was getting bigger, more detailed, and then suddenly, Charlie saw the pale skin, the dark brown spill of hair, all the elements that added up to Sam. He started to cry as he ran toward his son. Sam, he called, thinking, look at me, look at me, as if his son's seeing him would make Sam real. Sam! Sam didn't move. And then Charlie saw his arm held out stiff, stitched from the wrist to the elbow in neat black crosses that made Charlie's head reel.
Daddy, Sam said. I got stitches.
Sam winced when Charlie touched his cheek.
Daddy, he said.
It hurt. He had quite a gash, the nurse said. She took off the blood pressure cuff and patted his shoulder. You'll have a scar. Like a little souvenir, she told him. Something to make you special. Sam stared down at his arm. We gave him a nebulizer for his asthma, the nurse said. Charlie hugged Sam tight against him. He could feel his small chest rising and falling, the rapid bird-like beat of his heart. He could smell his sour breath. Daddy, Sam whispered. His voice sounded funny. Charlie pushed back his son's hair to check his face, shoved up the sleeves to check the bones, the skin purpled here and there, each bruise like a punch to Charlie's gut. You're okay, Charlie said in wonder. He hugged Sam again as tightly as he could, but Sam felt cold and clammy, and Charlie noticed his lips were a little blue. He looked up at the nurse. He's going to be fine. This is one strong boy, I'll tell you that fact. The nurse's voice was loud and strong, but then she tapped Charlie and drew him away, where Sam couldn't hear. He's in shock, she said quietly. He might feel and act stunned for a while. Just give him lots of love and he'll be fine. Charlie turned back to Sam, hugging him close. Sam struggled free. His eyes were enormous, the pupils dark and glassy, but distant, too, as though he wasn't seeing Charlie, even though he was looking right at him.
I ran, Sam blurted. I ran from the car.
That's all right. That's good. I'm glad you ran. Otherwise, you might have gotten hurt in the car.
I didn't know what else to do.
You ran, and you're all right. Charlie swallowed. What were you doing in the car, kiddo? Where were you and Mommy going?
They won't let me see Mommy, Sam said.
My wife, he said to the nurse. Another stretcher, pushed by a man, wheeled past.
You'll have to find a doctor, the nurse said. Lots of people here tonight.
You sit tight, Charlie said to Sam. Stay with the nurse, and I'll find Mommy.
He couldn't wait to see her. They'd hug and cry, and in the light of this,
Their morning argument would be no more than a piece of lint they'd brush away and forget. Everything was fine. Sam was okay. April was probably bruised or bandaged. Too scary for a little boy to see, and, of course, Sam would need preparation for a thing like that. Explanation and reassurance. He was only a quarter of the way down the hall when a voice called,
"Mr. Nash."
Charlie turned. A doctor, bookended by two cops in uniform resembling Canadian Mounties, was coming toward him. All their faces were drawn, like coin purses.
"Mr. Nash."
The doctor was in green scrubs, a mask slung about his neck.
"Where's my wife?"
Charlie asked the doctor.
"Mr. Nash."
Charlie looked around.
"Is she on another floor?"
He noticed suddenly a faint splotch of mustard on the doctor's sleeve.
"I'm so sorry," the doctor said.
Later, this is what he remembered. The cops asking him the same unanswerable questions the Massachusetts cops had asked him. The cops asking his permission to talk to Sam, and Sam refusing to say anything, even with Charlie standing there beside him, holding his hand. A nurse handing him a small plastic bag of April's belongings. Her wallet, her comb, and a handkerchief. Everything so familiar. Two doctors asking him about the donor card they'd found in her wallet, wanting him to sign papers so her organs could go to someone else. Someone else would touch April's skin. Someone else would see through her eyes. They asked him about signing papers for an autopsy, and then about a funeral home. He stood there, staring. "We can refer you to someone in Oak Rose," the social worker said gently, and he nodded. He remembered going into the room to see her. An ordinary, empty room with a long table and his wife lying on it, casually, as if she were just resting. Her face relaxed, her skin as pale as stationery. A faint smile on her lips, as if even with her eyes closed, she knew he was there, and she was happy to see him. He touched the hem of her dress, one he had never seen before. For a moment, he thought, maybe it's not April. There was a triangle of skin on her cheek that was gray. He cupped her face, stroked her arms, her legs. "Breathe," he said. He got up on the table and lay beside her, wrapping one arm about her. He shut his eyes, and then he heard the door open, steps coming toward him. "Mr. Nash," a voice said, and he opened his eyes and saw the damned social worker again, but he couldn't move. Couldn't make his legs work. She touched his arm again, and this time he stiffened. "Is there someone I can call for you?" she said. "Call April, my wife." She was quiet for a moment. "Is there someone else?" He shook his head. "I know how hard this is. I know how you must feel, but you can't stay here," she said. He thought of Ed, sitting in the waiting room, his head in his hands. "How do you know how I feel?" She put her hand on his shoulder. "My daughter died when she was 10. She choked on a piece of bubblegum." He shut his eyes. If he kept still, she might go away. "I'm going to call a funeral home for you. They can make arrangements to transport your wife home. Is that all right?" He felt a card touching his hand, and he opened his eyes. She had printed on it, "Roland Brothers Funeral Home." "She wanted to be cremated," he said, and she nodded. "I'll tell them,"
she said. But you need to take your son home.
Slowly, he lifted himself up off the table. He followed her down the corridor, along the red line and then the blue, and then to a small room. And there was Sam, fully dressed, a bandage along one arm, chatting away with one of the nurses. Sam took one look at Charlie's face and went silent.
Come on, we are going home,
he said quietly. And Sam slid off the hospital bed and took Charlie's hand, holding it tight. The police were waiting, their hands awkward in their pockets.
You have a way to get home?
One cop asked. Charlie nodded. Then he went to find Ed, and as soon as Ed saw Charlie's face, Ed stood up and did something he had never done before. He wrapped both arms about Charlie and squeezed.
Come on, Ed said. I'll take you both home.
It was late. The neighborhood was dark. Curtains were drawn. Down the block, the Gallagher's yellow tabby was yowling in heat.
Are you going to be all right?
Ed asked. And Charlie thought of Ed's wife, a lean, pretty woman with red curly hair, who must be up worrying about him. Charlie rubbed Ed's shoulder.
You've done more than I can ever thank you for.
Go home, he said. Sam staggered a few steps on the sidewalk. Charlie picked him up, a bundle of warm, sleepy boy, with a jagged cut all along one arm. It would leave a scar, he thought. Charlie took Sam into his room, gently laying him on the bed. As soon as Sam's head rested on the pillow, he was asleep. Charlie sat down on the bed beside Sam. He couldn't go into his own bedroom. He couldn't move about in his own house. The phone rang, and he let it. The bed was narrow, but Charlie gently lay down beside Sam and threw one arm about him, drawing him close, watching his son's chest rise and fall. He bent and kissed his cheek. I ran, Sam had told him. Ran where? Ran to what? What was Sam even doing outside the car? What was April doing on that road 3 hours away? Where were they going? And why hadn't he known anything about it? He's in shock, the nurse had said. Charlie lay awake, staring into the dark, listening to the creaking of the house. Then he got up and went to get the plastic bag of April's belongings that he'd left on the front table. He upended it on the living room floor. Her wallet, a spray of change, and some makeup. Everything was tinged black, edged in smoke. He felt as if he had been sucker punched. He sank to the floor, feeling sick. He used to laugh at those movies where men would lift their wives' clothes and inhale. Now Charlie held April's blue handkerchief to his face, but it smelled only of smoke. He let it drop. Charlie's hands began to shake. He shoved the bag to the far corner of the floor. Why didn't she tell him she was going someplace with Sam? Was she still angry about the argument? Was this her way of cooling off, go someplace and come back before he even knew she was gone? He strode to the bedroom and opened her drawers, flinging out the brochures she kept for places and sites she wanted to visit. The Frank Lloyd Wright Falling Water House in Pennsylvania, the Whetstone Park of Roses in Ohio. Was that where they were headed? She hadn't left him a note. She hadn't told him anything was wrong. Everything was still here, but dear fucking Jesus, she had stood in the middle of a road with the car turned around the wrong way, and she had taken Sam. Love you. The night before she left, when they first got into bed, before they had argued, she had said that to him, whispering it against his neck. Love you. Most mornings there was a quick kiss because they were both rushing off, because Sam was going to be late for camp or school. He had touched the tip of her nose, smiling at her. "Say it back to me," she always said. And he always said, "Don't you know by now?" Every morning, like a dear, familiar routine. But they had fought that morning. He had said terrible things he hadn't meant. She hadn't given him a chance to fix it. When he stood up, his head reeled. Everything looked different to him now, as if the colors were all a shade off. The air had a strange metallic taste, and he was suddenly shivering. Charlie yanked open the bedroom closet. There were the dresses she never wore, the jackets of his that she lived in. He grabbed up handfuls and threw them to the floor. He wasn't sure what he was looking for, what he thought he'd find, but he looked through her pockets. Nothing. Nothing. There was nothing but this huge pile of her clothes, and the only thing wrong was that she wasn't in any of them. The closet was just about empty when he saw the suitcases. They'd bought four of them just last year, a matched set of red leather, because April thought no one else might have red. A snap to find in the airport, she told him. There were only three suitcases in the closet. The biggest one was gone. Chapter 3. The first time Charlie saw April, she had a black eye. He was at the Leaning Tower of Pizza. The place was a big, cavernous barn with wood tables covered in red oilcloth that the waitresses were always wiping down. Red nets were slung across the ceiling, and the blackboard listed 35 kinds of pizza. Of course, he knew it was a tourist trap, but they had great pizza. They were open 24 hours a day, and Charlie knew all the waitresses. Charlie liked sitting at the communal tables, making conversation with the summer people. He liked feeling like a native who could tell people the best places to go for crabs, the best movie theater, and why aloe was a natural healer for the sunburns they almost always had. And sometimes, too, he liked bringing dates here, though lately, he'd been coming alone more and more. Tonight, the place was packed, and it was all he could do to find a tiny table wedged in the corner. The waitresses in red-checked aprons speed-walked past him, and Charlie lifted his hand, trying to get their attention. He was about to go to the counter and get his order to go when he heard a tray crash. People catcalled and stamped their feet. He looked over and saw a shimmering diamond field of broken glass and ice chunks, and right in the center was a waitress he had never seen before, tall and pale, with vanilla-colored hair cut short and as shaggy as a boy's. She was crouched over the plates, her back a curve. Usually, the waitresses got upset when such a thing happened, but this woman seemed completely unconcerned about the chaos. She didn't seem to hear the uproar around her. He couldn't stop looking at her graceful neck, the spiky points of her hair. He wanted to stroke her back, and he got up and walked over to help her. It wasn't until she looked up, turning her face to his, that he saw her black eye. Startled, without thinking, he plucked up some ice from one of the spilled drinks and brought it to her eye. And when he did, to his shock, he felt heat radiating from her skin, melting the cube so it dripped along his hand. She gazed at him calmly, and he dropped the ice cube. "Butterfingers," the waitress said. Her voice was low and had a hint of a drawl. The corners of her mouth curved up. She turned and went into the back, cinching her apron tighter about her. Charlie felt as if he had been struck. Black eye or not, he had never seen a more beautiful woman. He forgot the pizza he had wanted. The whole world seemed to have narrowed down to her, all pale and black and blue. After that, it was pizza every night. Charlie always sat at the same table and watched her. She never bothered to hide the eye with makeup, never looked away when anyone stared rudely. What was her story? He wondered. Was she a runaway wife, and the black eye was her ex's goodbye? And she walked into a door, gotten into a fight with a rival for some man's affections. There were a million things that could have happened to her, and all he wanted was for her to happen to him. He just wasn't quite sure how to make that so. He told himself it was ridiculous. What did he know about her, really? Was she smart? Did she read? Did she even want a relationship? He chewed thoughtfully at the end of a crust. She was the only one of the waitresses who didn't have a name tag, who didn't joke with the customers, who moved about the restaurant like a guest, who was just taking orders as a favor. "What's that new waitress's name?" he asked Judy, one of the oldest servers. "Why? Did she do something bad?" Judy asked. No, I just want to know," he said. And then Judy grinned and told him, "Her name's April, and she's a royal pain in the ass." April nodded at Charlie when she spotted him, but she never came over to talk, too busy juggling plates and glasses and pizzas and demanding customers. When she disappeared for her breaks, it unsettled Charlie. But one day, instead of running out, April whipped off her apron and settled at a table, taking out a notebook and furiously writing. He watched her, his heart knocking. It was ridiculous not to ask her to dinner. All she could say was no, and he had dealt with no's before. He left his mushroom and green pepper slice and walked over. "April," he said. She looked up at him, as if she had been expecting him. Her eye was nearly healed, only a faint blush of yellow at one corner. He glanced down at her notebook. "Why can't I be like that?" she had written. And then, "April," said another voice, and April looked up past Charlie, her face lighting up. She quickly crumpled up the piece of paper. "There you are, Mick," she said, and Charlie withdrew. Mick was beefy and tall, with a black leather jacket slung over his shoulders, even though it was almost 80 degrees outside. Mick tugged April close to him. "Come on, kitty cat," he said. "We've got miles to go tonight." And April flung off her apron and wiped her hands on her hips. She put down her order pad and followed Mick outside, just as if she were hypnotized. Charlie sat back at the table, watching from the window. April settled herself on Mick's motorcycle, hooping her arms tightly around him. She rested her cheek against his back, her beautiful eyes half closing. The bike zoomed off in a loud roar. Charlie pushed his pizza away. He wasn't hungry, and he felt foolish. He had a crush, and that was all. She was just a waitress at a pizza joint. He hadn't had a single conversation with her, except for the thousands he carried on in his mind. And really, whose fault was that? "I'm a fool," he thought. "A grown man acting like an idiot." Suddenly, the noise and chaos of the place got to him. The couples holding hands, the families teasing their children, the summer people in their touristy Cape Cod t-shirts. Everyone was spinning and moving, and he felt as if he were standing still. He put down a few wrinkled bills for a tip, and then he left too. After that, Charlie stopped going to the Leaning Tower of Pizza. Instead, he went to Pie in the Sky 3 blocks away, where the pizza was more gluey, the atmosphere less lively. But at least he didn't have to see April. He didn't have to picture her getting on the motorcycle with Mick. He went out with his friends, or he simply went home, sitting on his front porch and waiting for her to fade from his imagination. One night, a few weeks later, Charlie went to the beach. It was a cloudy, unseasonably cool night. Kids piled into cars and honked their horn as they passed Charlie. It was the kind of weather that tricked you into thinking the summer was already gone. Charlie walked the deserted beach, hands deep in his pockets. It was a private beach, and he was the only one on it. So when he heard a splash, he imagined it was a fish of some sort, come too close to shore. When he heard the splash again, he turned. And that's when he saw, at the other end of the beach, April, in a thin, short summer dress, wading into the water, and then suddenly breaking into a swim. For a moment, he thought it was just a mirage. He looked around for Mick, but the beach was empty. It was crazy to swim alone, even more so at night when no one was around, when you'd blend with the sky and disappear. Even from here, he could see how far out she was. "Hey!" he shouted, but she didn't seem to hear. He waved his hands wildly in the air. He shucked off his jeans and t-shirt, kicked out of his shoes, and headed for the water himself. The cold shucked him, making his teeth chatter. Waist deep, he stepped on the edge of a sharp rock and his toes recoiled. Damn! Damn! What was he thinking? What was she? He began to swim, fast, until he was out over his head. He couldn't see her. "Hey!" he shouted again, treading water, turning around. What had happened to her? He shouted, "April! April!" And then suddenly, there was her head, her hair dark and slick with water, smooth as a seal. And when she turned to him, he saw that her eyes were as shiny as moons, and full of surprise. "Leg cramp," she panted. She winced as he pulled her to him. Her dress, soaked with water, tugged around them both. Putting one arm about her, drawing her close, he swam to the shore. "I've got you," he said. It was freezing on shore. Shivering, he snatched his black t-shirt and handed it to her. And then he dragged on his jeans, which grew damp as soon as they touched his skin. He rubbed at his arms, and then turned to look at her. "Are you okay?" he asked. "What were you doing out there swimming alone? Why did you go in wearing your dress?" "What are you doing alone?" she said. His t-shirt was long on her, like another dress. Her black eye was gone, but somehow, she still looked wounded to him. "Thinking," he said. "So was I, and I thought a swim would clear my head. I didn't have a suit handy, so I thought I'd make do with what I had." She smoothed the shirt down over her body. "Let me buy you dinner," Charlie blurted. "Dinner? It's past midnight. And why would I let you do that?" He suddenly felt awkward.
"Because I think I just saved you."
"I wasn't in danger. It just looked that way." She looked down at her body, as if she had just noticed she was wearing his shirt. Then she looked back at him. "Thank you." He held out his hand.
"Charlie Nash, from the Leaning Tower of Pizza."
He felt like an idiot. Why would she remember him from all her customers? She nodded and then briefly took it. "April," she said finally. "April Jorgen, and I should get home."
"I'll walk you."
"I don't live in such a great area," she said. He walked beside her, his hands in his pockets, letting her direct him through the shortcuts. He couldn't help it. He felt ridiculously happy, even though he was freezing and damp. A collie chained to a front fence barked wildly, straining to get free. "Right here." She stopped in front of a small gray apartment building. There was a rusted fence surrounding it. Some of the windows had green paper shades. "Thank you for the rescue." She smiled at him, and he felt that sudden shock again.
"Have dinner with me next week," he said.
She studied him. "Anything but pizza," she said. A week later, he took her to River Nile, a little Ethiopian place where you sat on the floor around low, round tables and shared.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.